creating and managing partitions in our Linux system. Now for creating the partitions, we can do it at the time of installations. And when at the time of installation, if we have used the whole space of the hard disk and then we don't have any available space, then we cannot create any other partitions. So we can do what? We can add an extra hard disk into our system, and then we can use this extra disk for the data. Like we have used the first disk, we have used the whole space for the system, so we can use the other disk for the data, and we can create partitions on that disk. So right now, what how many disks we have in our system? So right now we have only one disk. And to check that, what we do, we run the command fdisk-l. It will show you the list of partition available and the hard disk. So right now it is saying there is only one disk we have, that is SDA, with this capacity, with this size. SD is it means it is a SATA or SCSI, and A means it is the first hard disk. And here it is showing the number of partitions we have in this hard disk. Now if we want to have more partitions, and we can do hard disk also. So first I will add new hard disk into my system, then we will see how we can create partitions into it. And now I have added the new disk here in our system. Now I will go to the command terminal again. And now this time when I run fdisk-l, so it will show the new disk also. Now we have already this SDA disk already there, and it has all the partitions also. But now we have added one more disk, and that will be as a SDB. SDB, and the size is 60 GB. So my new disk name is SDB because it is a second disk. The first disk is SDA, and this one is the second one, SDB. As on, if I add one more disk, then it will be called SDC, then SDD, SDE, and then it will go on like this. So this is the second disk, this is the first disk, this is our system disk where we have installed the operating system, and this is the new disk which I have added here. The capacity is 64, it is actually 60 GB I have selected. But there is no partition it is showing here, because there is no partition we have created into this disk. Now if I want to create a partition, if I want to use the disk, then I have to create a partition into that disk so that I can use it. Now for creating the partitions, what we do, we use fdisk-fdisk, and then we will mention the disk name. This time we'll use SDB. So this is the disk which I want to create a new partition. So when I will give this command, so what happened, we'll get into this fdisk utility. Now it says welcome to fdisk, this is the version for it, and then it gives the information here, information saying changes will remain in the memory only until you decided to write them, and be careful before using the write command. Now it says one more thing here, does device does not contain a recognized partition table. So building a new DOS disk label with disk identifier. Now what it is doing here, because it is a fresh and new disk, there is no partition table. Partition table, that means it is not MBR, it is not GPT. So what it is doing, it is creating DOS disk label. That means it is actually creating MBR. Now why it is creating MBR? Because we are using the command fdisk. So when we use the command fdisk to create a partition, always convert your disk into MBR. Now why it is not converting into GPT? Because for GPT, actually we have a different util. We have different utility, we have different command. So we will see that also. First we'll see how we can create a partition here. Now remember, because it is converting into MBR, so in MBR what we can do, we can create only four partitions. So if we create primary partitions, then only we can create four partitions. But if we want to have more than four partition, then we have to create one extended partition. And in that extended partition, we can create any number of logical drives, and logical drives that means will be that logical drives will be inside the extended partition. That will look like a real look like a normal partition, but they are called as a logical drive because they created under the extended partition. Now let's see, if I want to create a new partition, I will create by using n command. Now this time there is no partition here in this disk, so when I press n to create new partition, it says, do you want to create primary partition or you want to create extended partition, because there is no partition created here. Now total number is what, 4, and saying 4 is free. That means we can create 4 partitions here. There is no primary partition, there is no extended partition created here. So what you want to create, you can select P for primary, E for extended. By default it is already selected P, so it wants to create primary partition first, so it is already selected P. But we want, then we can change it to E also. I will go with the default. I will say I want to create a primary partition. Now it says using the default response, that is P, and that means it is going to create the primary partition. Now it is saying what will be the number for your partition. So we have four options available, 1, 2, 4, and by default it is selecting 1. That means we, whatever the partition we are creating, if I press enter here directly, then it is going to give the number 4 to our first partition. So I will use the default. So I say okay, this one I need this. So I'll say okay, use 1. Now after deciding all these things, like we have decided the partition will be primary, we have decided the number of the partition 1. Now it is asking that what will be your first sector. First sector, that means your starting point of your partition. So the total space we have available, so total space, that means we are available from 2048 sector, from this sector to this number of sectors are available. So where you want to start, so I will start always from the beginning. So by default it is already selected from the first sector, available sector. So I will press enter here to go with the default, and it says now using the default value for 2048. Now it is saying where you want to end the partition, like what will be the size of your partition, what is the last sector you want. So if we understand the sector values, the sector value is 512 byte. So if you want to create a 10 GB partition, then you should know that how many sectors you can combine to create 10 GB, to get 10 GB. That means if suppose you want to create 10 GB, so you have to multiply 512 bytes, how many times that you will reach up to 10 GB. Now if you know the calculation, then you can mention it like plus, and then you can mention the number of sector you want. Now if you don't understand the sector values, then what you can do, you can do create the partition directly in MB, GB and KB. So I want 1 GB partition, so I will say I want 1 G. So the partition value, partition size will become 1 GB. Now it says the partition 1 of type Linux and the size 1 GB is set. Now by default always it will create the type Linux, that is 83. We want to check it, so we can check by using P command, and it says here the SDB1 is created, the size is this, and the type is normal Linux 83. Now I want to create one more partition. Remember, one primary is already created, so I want to create one more. Now this time it will say again, do you want to create primary or extended? One primary is already created and no extended is created, and we have available number 3. So 3 partitions we can create. Again it is by default selecting what, primary. So I'll go with primary. Number I will go with the default number for 2. Then for the starting point I will go for the default, and for the ending point, like what will be the size, so I'll say plus 1 GB. So I'm creating one more 1 GB partition here. Now we have 2 partition created, and those 2 partitions are primary. SDB1, SDB2, both are primary, 1 GB, and the type is normal Linux. Now I want to create one more partition. Again N for new partition. Now this time it is saying again, you want to create primary or extended? 2 primaries are created, 2 options are available, and no extended is created. So default is again primary. So I'll say okay, I want primary. number, I will go with the default number. Starting sector, I will go with the default, then plus 1 GB partition. Now three primaries are created. When you press P, you can see the three partitions are created of 1 GB, and all three partitions are primary partitions. Now if we want to create another partition, that means the partition number 4, then that partition can be primary partition or can be extended partition. But if I create the primary partition, then I cannot create any other partition, because we can create only primary partitions, or only 4 partitions. Now instead of primary, if I create the extended partition, then in that extended I can create any other logical drives. Now let's see, I want to create new partition now, and when you see here, it says you want primary or extended. By default, 3 primaries are already created and 1 is free. So we have one option available. Now by default, what it is selecting here is E. This is the default behavior. So when 3 primaries are created, then what it will do, it will by default go for extended, because it knows that if suppose you have not used the whole space, then the remaining space will be wasted. That means you cannot use that remaining space to create any more partition, because you have already created 4 partitions. So if I don't go with the extended and I say I want to create the primary partition, so I say I want primary, and then I will press P, and the number automatically it is using 4, because there is the, that is the only number which is remaining. Then it is asking for the starting point. I will go with the default. Now for the ending point, that means the end of the partition, the size, so I'll say plus 1 GB. Remember, our hard disk is 60 GB, and I am creating 1 1 GB partitions. So I have created 4 primary partitions of 1 1 GB, so the rest of the whole space is remaining. That means more than 50 GB is remaining. It is created. So 4 partitions are created of 1 1 GB. Now when you see with P command, you can see the 4 partitions are there, and all those partitions are 1 1 GB and Linux, normal Linux 83. Now the remaining space, we have a lots of remaining space available. We can verify by V command. So we have lots of unallocated sectors available. Now if I want to create new partition and I press N, I want to use the unallocated sectors now. So when I press N to create new partition, it says that if you want to create more than 4 partition, you must replace a primary partition with an extended partition first. That means we cannot create more than 4 partitions, more than 4 primary partitions. So if we want to create more than 4, then we have to use extended. So I will use what? Extended this time. Now for extended, what I have to do, I have to delete one of the partition from here. So I will use D command to delete, and I will delete the 4th one. Now I have deleted the 4th one, and now we have only 3 primaries. Now this time when I create new partition, I will go with extended. And in extended, the starting point I will go with the default, and the ending point, what I will do, I will go with the default. That means I will use the whole remaining space. Why? Because if I leave any space, then it will not be useful, because we cannot use that space. So I will go with the whole space now, and I will create a extended partition with the whole remaining space. The whole remaining space was 57 GB. Now the extended partition number 4 is created, and this partition is what? The size of 57 GB. Now this extended partition, we can't use it. You see this? This is the extended partition. We cannot use it, like we cannot mount it on any directory. This is the extended partition. We can do what with this extended partition? We can create a logical drives inside this extended partition. So in MBR partitioning table, what we have? We have only option to create 4 partitions, but in case we need more than 4, then we have this extended partition option. Now this time when I try to create new partition, what it says here, that all primary partitions are unused, and directly it is adding the logical partition, that number 5. So all 4 is there, so it is using the number 5 here. Now I will go with the default for the starting, and for the size I will say 1 GB. So I created one logical drive inside the extended one. So as you can see, this is the starting point for the extended and this is the ending point, but we are creating under that. So you can see the starting point is same as this and ending point is in between this. So the partition which we created, it is actually the it is in between this extended partition. I can now create n numbers of logical drives, so we can create as many as we want. I will go with the new one, default plus 1 GB, two logical drives. I want, I can create more, 1 GB, three logical drives. Now what we have three primary, three logical and one extended partition. Now when you see the partition here, the primary partitions and the logical partitions, they look similar. There is no difference between this. So you can see they are same, they are having the same type, they are having the same thing, no any extra thing. If you don't see this extended, then you will not understand that these three is logical drives and these three is primary partition. You can see the size, type is all thing are same. Now how you will know that these partitions are the logical drives and these partitions are the the primary partitions? So if you want to know in Linux, then any partition, if you see in Linux any partition more than 4 number, remember, if the partition number is more than 4, that is 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, so in a Linux, in MBR partitioning table, if you see the number of the partition is more than 4, that is 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, whatever, that all partition will be logical drives. And when you see any number from 1 to 4, that means these partitions will be primary partitions. And extended, you can directly see the type here. You can identify the type, you can say, okay, this is extended. But you can see the numbers, 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, the numbers are reserved for the primary partitions. And after that, these numbers are for the logical drives. Now, why I'm saying I created the partitions in sequence, but if suppose I create the extended partition in first. For example, I will delete all these partitions first. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2 and 1. Now there is no partition we have. Now suppose I want to create new partition and directly I will create extended partition. The first partition. And I will create it like it is as a 50 GB. So I created directly extended partition, the partition which is number 1. Now if I create the another partition, then what the number for the partition will be 2. But if you create the logical drives, then it will always start from number 5. So this time when I try to create new partition, so we get two options. Either you can create primary, because we have available options, three options available. The only option we use is one, that is extended. Now it says you can create logical drive, and for logical drives we can use L, because we have extended partition already created, so we can create now logical drives also. Now when you create the logical, it says here that it numbered from 5, so it will not give the number 4 or number 2 to the logical drive, it will directly start from 5. Let's see, I will create logical drive of 1 GB. Now what number it is getting after number 1, SDB 1, directly it is getting SDB 5, because SDB the drive number 1, 2, 3, 4 are reserved for primary and extended. and number 5 is starting. The number 5, the logical drives will start from number 5. So whenever I create new logical drives, they will get the number after 5. And if I create the primary partition, they will get the number after 1, 2, 3. So we can easily say that these two is a primary partitions and these two is a logical drives. So this is how it works. Now, why it has created the MBR partitioning table when we use the fdisk command? Because the fdisk command is dedicated to MBR. We cannot use it for managing or creating GPT partition table or GPT partitions. So this command, fdisk command, is only for managing the MBR partitioning table. So if we want to create the GPT or use manage the GPT partitions, then what we use another utility, another command. Now, if you have any partition on the disk, then you cannot convert it into GPT. Or if it is GPT and you have any partition there, then you cannot convert it into MBR. So for converting them, what we need to delete every partition. We have to lose the whole data. So I will delete these partitions here. Now I will exit without saving. So what we did, we have not created any partitioning table here, neither MBR, neither GPT. Still it is free because I have quit without any saving changes, any changes. I have not saved any changes. So for using it or creating it, a GPT partition table, we have a command gdisk. So instead of fdisk, we should use gdisk. Now to list, the same command is l. Actually the options are almost same. The command fdisk or gdisk, the options are almost same. So if I want to list, so I will use gdisk hyphen l. Now here it will not work like l. We have to mention the name of the disk also. That means if I want to check the SDA, so I will say I want to see the list of partitions of this partition, this hard disk SDA. Now when I press enter here, what it says here? It says here that the partition table is scanned. It has scanned the partition table, and then what it says, MBR only. This is MBR only because this hard disk is already in MBR. There is no BSD partition table, there is no AMP partition table, there is no GPT partition table found. It only found that this is MBR. It says found the valid GPT, found invalid GPT and valid MBR, converting the MBR to GPT format. Now it is showing the output as a format of GPT, but it is not converting the hard disk. It cannot because it is having a partitions. So it is converting the output for the GPT style. So what it is saying here, it is saying this is the hard disk, this is the size, this is the sector size, which is 512 byte. Then partitions, it can hold up to, now you can see here it is saying that partition holds up to 128 entries. So we can create 128 partitions in GPT. We cannot, we don't have to create extended partition, there is no option because we don't need it. We can create directly 128 primary partitions. That is more than enough we have. First enable sector is this, last enable sector is this, usable sector is this. First usable sector, first last usable sector is this. Partition will be aligned with this, and total free space is available this. It is also showing the free space. Then it is showing the partition numbers and size and type. Now here only the difference is this code. In fdisk it shows 83 and GPT in gdisk it shows 8300. Now this hard disk is already MBR and we cannot convert it. For converting it, I have to remove all the partitions. We cannot convert it. So we have the other disk which is not having any partitioning table, SDB. Now what it says here, there is no partition table available, no present, not present, not present, no MBR, no BSD, no APM, no GPT, and it is creating new entries. There is no partition also there. So the size is 60 GB, total size is free, there is no partition. Now if I want to use this hard disk to convert it into GPT, then I will use this gdisk command, same as we use the fdisk command. So what I will do, I will use gdisk, then I will mention the hard disk name, SDB. Now it says here what, there is nothing present here, but it is now creating what, new GPT entries. So if I create any partition and saved it, then it will become GPT partitioning table. Now here for the help, you have to press question mark. In fdisk you will press M. Now when I press a question mark here, it shows all the options. The options are almost same, like B for creating the backup the GPT data to file. You have C to change the partition system name. Then you have D to delete the partition, that is same. I, it will give you the detailed information about the partition. L to list the known partition type, that is also same. Now in L you will see the ID code is different. Here it shows the codes which is different than the fdisk. In fdisk for the Linux file system it is 83, here it is 8300. For the Windows it was 7. For NTFS here it is saying what, 0700. Rest of the things are almost same, like to create the new partition we'll use the N command, to create the empty GUID partition table we can use U, P to print the partition table, Q to quit without saving, R to recovery and transmission option, that is for only experts. Then we have S to sort the partitions, T to change the system type, and then V to verify the disk, W to save the changes, X for extra functionality, and this question mark is for the help. So almost the options are same. I want to create new partition, I'll go with N. Then how much number it is showing here, there is no, it is not showing that primary, extended or logical, it is directly showing we have a number from 1 to 128. That means we can create all partitions up to 128, and all the partitions will be primary. So there is no need for extended, because all the partitions by default will be created as a primary partition. We can go on to create this. Now again it is saying what is the first sector. We have available sectors from here to this, and this is the default one which is selected. So you can use the default one, or you can add more, like you can add plus or minus, you can add, and then you can add the size in KB, MB, GB and TB. So I will go with the default for the first sector. Now again for the last sector, it will decide the size of your hard disk partition. So I will say plus 1 GB. Now in this GPT, in this gdisk, when you are creating the hard partition, it will ask you to go for the system ID also. So you can change the ID, you can change the type directly at the time of creating. In fdisk, first you create the partition, then you change it. Here you can directly change it when you create it. So by default it is going for the Linux, normal Linux 8300, but if you want, then you can use the other type also. Like for example, you can go for the NTFS also, you can go for the other types. But remember, these all types are not supported. Only we have supported some of the types, and if we want to have more types, then if you suppose want to have a support of NTFS, then we have to update our kernel. I'll go with 83 default. P for printing the partition table, and this is what we have created. We can create new partitions, we can create new mode, and we can now create, you can see now available numbers are from 2 to 128. I create one more partition of 1 GB. Now this time you want, you can create another type. For example, I want to create for the Microsoft basic data, that is NTFS. So I will say 0700 I want. And this new partition is what? For the Microsoft data. Now this is what NTFS, and we can't use it because the NTFS is, our kernel is not updated with the NTFS, so we can delete it. Same for deleting, we have D. Then you can mention the number of the partition and you can delete it. Now there is no partition available. There is one partition available, the other one we have deleted. So this is what for GPT, and the fdisk is for the MBR. I have deleted this one also, and then I can go quit without saving. So this is how we do what, create the partitions by using the fdisk. You will create the MBR partitioning table. For using the gdisk, you can create the GPT partitioning table. So after creating the partition, what is the process? Process is very simple. First you have to create the file system, then you have to mount it, mount the partition into any drive using the mount command. For creating the file system, you can use mkfs dot and whatever the file system you want. You want ext2, 3, 4, FAT, you want XFS. So whatever you want, you can create. And right now, by default, our kernel, our Linux kernel only support this number of, this type of file systems. So after creating the file system, we can do what? We can use this, we use a partition by mounting it on our drive. So mention the partition name, the partition which you want to use, and then the directory name which, where you want to mount it. And after mounting, you will see that by using this command, that the partition is mounted. You can see the partition is mounted on which directory, what is the total size, what is the available size. So next is what, RED. RED means redundant array of interconnected devices or interconnected disk. So what it do here and why we use this, it is actually for the high availability, high availability for of data. That means if suppose we install some application, we use the server for some services, so these services or application need to store the data, and they need to have a data every time so that the application or services keep running. If the data is not available, the services will not run. And if we store the data into a single disk and that disk goes down, then we can lose the data and the application and services will stop. So we want to make sure that the services and applications are keep running every time. So we should make sure that the data is also available every time. So we can't depend on the physical thing, hardware can anytime fail. So what we can do, we can create an array of disk and combine those disks to create a single partition, and that partition we can use to store the data for the application or services. So what happened in the background, it is stored into the multiple disk, and if one of the disk goes down, then what, the data will still be available for the services because of RED. So RED actually provide the redundancy among the disk. So instead of using the one disk, what we can do, we can combine multiple disks, and then what we'll do, we create a single partition on it, and then we use that partition to store the data. Now what happened if suppose we lose one of the disk, still the data will be available from the other disks. So this is what the main objective of RED. Now we have RED, in RED we have different levels, like level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5. It starts from level 0. So first we have level 0. Now this level 0 is actually called strip volume. It is a strip volume. Now what is strip volume do? It will strip the data. Strip the data, that means if suppose we create, we combine two disks. If we combine two disks and use combine these two disks to create a single RED volume 1 partition, Now what it have it do, it will strip the data. Now suppose if we enter the data, if you store the data into this partition, then what the red do, red will store the data into both the disks, and it will do the stripping. Stripping, that means the one data will go here, then second data will go here, then the third data will go here, then fourth data will go here, 6, 7, like this. So it suppose I type the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so 1 will go here, then 2 will go here, then 3 will go here, then 4 will go here, then 5 will go here, then 6 will go into this disk. So it will do the stripping. Now in this red level 0, we can use minimum of 2 disks to create the redundancy, and maximum up to, we can go up to 32 disks to combine to create a single volume. Single volume, that means a single partition. So either we can combine 2, or we can go up to maximum 32 disks to combine and to create a single red volume 1. Now this red level 1, what it will do, it will do the stripping, and it will do what, it will give you the redundancy. It will not give you the redundancy, it will give you what, it will give you the performance. It will give us the reading and writing speed. It will give the performance, it will give the combined space. Combined space, that means if this hard disk is 1 GB, this hard disk is 1 GB, so the partition we create, it will be 2 GB. We'll get the combined space, and also we get what, we get the speed of reading and writing, but we don't get the redundancy, because the half of the data is here and half of the data is here. So if, even if we lose one of the disk, we have lose the whole data. So we cannot recover the data. So it will not give the redundancy. It is only for the two things. It is only for using the combined space, and it is also using, it is only for giving the performance, but it is not for the redundancy. So for redundancy, we use what? We use red level 1. Red level 1 we use. Now red level 1 is called mirror volume. Now mirror volume means what? It creates the mirror. Now here we can use minimum or maximum. We can use only 2 disks. Either we use minimum or maximum, we can say we can only use 2 disks. We cannot use more than 2 disks. Now what it do here, it creates the mirror data. Mirror data, that means if we use the minimum or maximum 2 disks, so what it will do here, we combine these 2 disks to create a single mirror volume. So what it will do here, it will create the mirror image. If suppose we get we store the data into this mirror volume, so what the red do, red will store the data here in this disk, and the same data it will store onto the other disk also. That means if you store the data 1, 2, 3, 4, so 1, 2, 3 will be stored here also, and the same data will be stored on other disk also, 1, 2, 3. So actually it creates the same mirror image on both the disks. Now what is the benefit here? We'll get the full redundancy. Full redundancy, that means if we lose one of the disks, still we can get the data, because the data is available from the other disk. But there is a problem here, that we'll lose the performance. We lose the sum of the performance. It will not give you the performance like the strip volume, but and also it will reduce the disk space also. That means if this disk is 1 GB, this is also 1 GB, then the partition you get is only 1, not 2, because one of the disk is using one of the half of the space is going for the mirroring. So you will not get the full space, you will get the half of the space. So it reduces the performance a little bit than the strip volume, and also it will give you the half of the usable space. Half of the space will go for the mirroring, but it will give the full redundancy. Now because it is using the half of the space for the mirroring, it is not cost effective. If suppose I want to store 10 TB of data, so I need 20 TB of space. That is not, like, it is not cost effective. But it gives us the full redundancy. Now, if I want to have the cost effectiveness also. I want a strip performance of a strip volume also, and also I want to have a redundancy. Then what I can do, I can go for the other level. Now the other level is what? Level 2, 3, 4. Now level 2, 3 and 4 are all same like level 5. But level 2, 3 and 4 mostly people don't use. So people uses directly level 5, because level 5 is advanced, is it is having more option, it is a good, it is actually better than the 2, 3 and 4. So it is very rarely that somebody is use level 2, 3 or 4. So everyone actually uses level 5. So red level 5 is actually the strip volume, and it is with the parity, where we can use minimum 2, minimum 3 actually. Not 2, minimum 3 to 32 partition, 32 different disks to create a single volume. Now what it do here, if suppose we combine 3 disks like disk 1, disk 2 and disk 3 to create a single volume of level 5, then what it do here, it will do the stripping also, and it will also use the parity bit. So when you store the data here into this disk, like say for example I store 1, 2, 3, 4, so what it will do, it will do the stripping, it will do the stripping, that means the data will go on to write on the hard disk by using the stripping, like 1 will go here, so 2 will go here, the 3 will go here, so 4 will go here, like this. And in the third disk, it will store the parity bit. Parity bit can be, it is like a, like this, for example. Now, what you will get here, you will get the stripping, that means you will get the performance of the disk. Now you will get the combined space also, that means you will get more than the space of mirror. Like you will, if suppose this is 1, this is 1 and this is 1 GB, then you will get the space, you will get the usable space up to 2 GB. 2 GB of the 2 disk space. Now 1 disk space will go for the parity. Now because of the parity, you will get the redundancy also. So among these 3 disks, if one of the disk goes failed, like if suppose this disk goes down, then still we can get the data from the parity disk. Because of the parity bit, we can still get the data. Now, how is it, how it is working, how is it doing that, how it is getting the data from a single parity disk, the data of the 2 disks of 1 GB. So is it like storing the backup of 2 GB data into 1 GB? No, it is not like that. It is actually parity bit. So it is actually using a way or method of, we can say, a binary equation. For example, I will give you the example here, a small example. Like when you store the data, so it goes, it because it is digital, so it goes like a binary values. So suppose this is my disk A, this is my disk B, and this is my disk C, that is my parity disk. So if it is stripping the data between A and B and storing the parity in P disk, then what will be the data like this? Data will be like this. In A, you will get the data like 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1. So in the other disk, it is writing the data like 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0 and 1. So what it will do in the parity, it will write like this, 1, 1 will become A, 1, 0 it will become 1, 0, 0 will become 0, 1, 1 will be 0, 1, 0 again it will become 1, 0, 1 will again become 1, and 0, 0 will remain 0, and 1, 1 will become 0. Now this will be the parity. Now if suppose any of the disk goes down, so what it will do, it will recover it because of the parity. So for example, I will say this disk goes down. Now we don't have this disk, it is corrupted. So when we add the recovery disk here, so it will get the data by calculating the parity again. So how? Now remember, this is not available, this A and B is available. So 1 1 is equal to 0, then 0 0 will become 0, then 1 0 will be 1, and 1 1 will be 0, then again 0 1 is 1, 0 0 will be 0, and 1 0 will be 1. Now if you compare this disk, this data, with the data which we had in B, so you can see it is the same, 0 0 1 0 1 and 0 1, and this is also 0 0 1 0 1 0 1. So this is just an example for the parity. It is very complicated, but it is just an example. Now one more thing, why everybody uses this level 5? Because it actually stores the parity in every disk. It is not like it is storing the parity into a separate disk. It actually stores the parity into all the disks. For example, it do what? It will strip the data on all three disks, and parity also it writes on all three disks. Like if you write 1, 2, 3, 4 data, so 1 will go here, then 2 will go here, and 3 will go, that the parity for this 1, 2 will go here. Then it will write second data, like for example A, we are adding second data. So A will go here, then parity will go store into this disk, and B will store into this disk. Then when you store another data, like for example we are storing XYZ, so what, the parity will store here for that data, then X will go here and Y will go here. Now what that means, it is actually storing the parity for the datas in different disks. So for this data, it is storing the parity here. For the second data, it is storing the parity here. For the third data, it is storing the parity here. So in this way, what happens, if suppose one of the disks goes down, we can still get the data. If even two disks goes down, still we can get the data, if the data is more than the size, not more than the size of the parity. But it is stored the parity because it stores the parity into all the disks. For example, if this disk goes down, so we can get the data from the other two disks. This B data will have the parity here, and X data, Y data goes down, but the parity is stored here. So we can get the data anyhow if suppose we lose more than two disks also. But again, it stores the parity in all the three disks, but still it will only use the size of one disk for parity. It will not use less than or more than the size of one disk. It always use the size of one disk for the parity. Either it is dividing the size into all three disks, but it will still use the size of total size of one disk for the parity. So that is why we can say that one disk will go for parity. The size of one disk will go for parity, and the size of two disks will be available for use. So it is still good. What we are getting here, we are getting the stripping, we are getting the parity. By parity, we are getting what, the redundancy. So mostly people use the red level 5. Now how we can configure it in our Linux system. So what we will do, we can configure it like we add three disks here, and we add the disk, like it will be named as SD, A, B, C. Right now A is our system disk, so I'm adding it for the data, so it will be like SDB. Then when I add one more disk, so it will be SDC. Then I add one more disk. This is the minimum for red level 5. So it will be named as SDD. Then if I create a party, now if I want to use them, so what I have to do, I have to create a partition of that hard disk. So whatever the size I want, I can use the partition of that size. Or if I want to use the whole disk, so I will create a single partition by using the whole space of the disk. So if I create the partition, so it will become SDB1, here it will become SDC1, then here it will become SDD1. Then what we'll do, we will combine all these three partitions to create a red partition. The partition name will be MD0. Now this MD is the standard name. 0 is for the first partition of red. Now if you want to create another volume, then it will be named as MD1. Then the third one will be MD2, MD3. So you can go on to create multiple. Like for example, if we want to install the Linux on the red volumes, then what we need? We need at least three partitions, which is what? System partition. So we will create MD0 for boot partition, then for MD1, I will create for the slash, then MD2 for swap, and then I will install the operating system on that. And this option we get when we start the installation. At the time of installation, when we select the manual partitioning, you will get this option also to create the partition as a red partition. Now we have already done the installation, so still we can create it. So we'll add different disk here, and then combining those partitions of the disk, we can create the red volume. Now after creating the red volume, we want to use it. So for using it, first we have to create the file system. Then we have to mount it. We have to mount it on a directory so that we can use it. Now when you mount it on any directory, by using the command mount, it will not be permanent. So what we have to do next, we have to make sure that it will be permanent. So for making it permanent, what we have to do, we have to add the entry into FS tab. Now after making permanent, before restarting the system, we should check that whether we have made the right configuration or not. So remember to check the configuration before rebooting your system. Otherwise your system can go into grub mode and it will not reboot. Then you have to go for the command and you have to go for rescue your system. So before rebooting your system, whatever you are doing the changes and saving the changes, so before rebooting you should check how changes are right or not. So for before rebooting, we should verify the changes. And for that, what we have the different process. Unmount the partition. If it is mounted, then run the command mount-a, and it will rephrase the mount table like you are rebooting the system. So if you see any error, that means you are having a problem. Solve the problem. If you don't see any error, that means you don't have any problem. You can restart the system. So now let's see how we can configure the red. Now what I have here, SDA, I have, this is the first disk where my operating system is already installed. Now I have added extra disks here for creating the red volume. So this is SDB, this is SDC, this is SDE, and we have also SDD, where there is no partition created in these disks. Now if we want to use the these disks for the red volume, so what we have to do, we have to create the partition in those disks, whether you want to use the whole space or you want to only the space which you want to create. So you can create, you have to create the partition into those disks. Now the partition type should be red Linux LVM, Linux red, red Linux. So we have to create the partition for the Linux red. So I will show you how. First I will create it into SDB. So I will use the fdisk command, dev SDB, and there is no partition there, so I will create new partition, primary, with the default number, and I will create it with the size of 5GB. Now when you create, so the type will be by default this 83 Linux, normal Linux. Now I want to change the type. We have to change the type to this Linux Red Auto. So whatever the partition you want to create, you will create with this type. The type ID is what? FD in FDisk. So we will use this ID. Now how you will change this? We'll use T command to change. Then we will mention the ID is FD. And now what? We created the partition, and that partition ID is what? FD, that means it is Linux Red Auto Detect. So same as I created into SDB hard disk, same we will do it for the other hard disk like SDC, SDD, SDE. So in each every disk after the SDA, in SDB I created this SDB1 of 5GB size with the type Linux Red. Then for SDC I created again the same. Then in SDD, SDE I created the same, and in SDD also I created the same. Now we have 4 partitions available with this type. Now we can create the red. So what I will do, for creating and managing the red volume we have a command mdadmin. This mdadmin command is to create or manage the red volumes. Now first I want to create it, so I will give the option create. Now what I want to create is under dev md0. This will be my red volume 1. This is my first volume, which is red volume 0. Now I have to decide the level. So hyphen hyphen level is equal to. Now level we can use what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But we can use 0. 0 is the strip volume, 1 is the mirror volume, and mostly people use 5. So I will go with 5. Level with 5. Then we can decide which disk we want to use for this. Now remember, for level the minimum is what? 3. But I have created 4 partitions. Why? Because I want to use one as a spare disk. Now what is the benefit of a spare disk? If suppose I don't use this spare disk, then what happened? So if suppose I don't select the spare disk, I have only 3 disks, which is the minimum one for the red 5. So this is the one, this is the one, and this is the one. And suppose these 3 disks are working properly, our red is working properly. Now what happens if one disk goes down? Still our data will be available, but the red is what? In the risk. Red is corrupted. Red will not be working properly. It will say the red is not working properly. It is having a problem. Red is having the error, because it needs 3 disks and 2 disks is available. Now at the time, if I don't see that, if I'm not monitoring it, I'm not seeing it, and if suppose at the same time if the second disk also goes down, then we will lose the data. So when the first disk goes down, so I have to see I have to keep monitoring it, and as soon as I see the first disk goes down, I have to remove the disk and add the fresh disk which is working, so that red will not go down. Now if I'm not monitoring it, if I'm not seeing it, and if one disk goes down, still everything is working, and if it is working, then I will not see that, I will not notice it, because everything is working. Now at the same time when the other disk goes down, then everything stops working, and now I know that okay, the red goes down, and now I lose everything, I lose the data also. But if suppose I have the spare disk available already, so this disk, extra disk will remain as a spare. Now 3 disks will be active and this disk will be as a spare. Now if one disk goes down, then without my intervention, what it will do? It will take the place of that corrupted disk automatically, and our red will work properly, and this corrupted disk will go as a faulty disk. It will remove it from the red and it will say this is the faulty disk. Now when I monitor the red, then I will see that okay, our one disk is now in faulty and our spare is now using, so I will get more time to fix it. So I will fix the disk problem and then I will reconnect, or I will connect the another disk or this disk, whatever, So the disk which I connect now, it will remain as a spare because this one is now working here as a active. So it will be helpful for me so that my head will not go directly down, it will still keep working. So we can use a spare disk, and it is a good practice to use it. Because of that, I can use a spare disk here. So what I will say here, I will say that minus minus spare device I want to use is equal to 1, and minus minus red devices I want to use 3, which is the minimum one. Then we will mention all these disk name which we want to use it in red level 5 in this red. Now we will mention all the disks like SDB1, SDC1, SDD1, and because remember we are using 4 here, 3 active and 1 spare, so we have to mention the name of 4 disks. So one by one we will mention it, like Dave SDB1, then Dave SDC1, then Dave SDD1, then Dave SDE1. Now the last name which you mentioned, it will go for spare. So if you want to make a spare disk, then you will mention it at the end of the line. Okay, my option is not right. Oh, okay, sorry, my spelling is wrong actually. And now it is created. It was my problem. Sorry, it is a spelling mistake. Okay, so it says what? The red array is started. This is the version for our red. Now, if we want to see the detail of our red, then we will use mdadm command to see the detail of our created md0. So this is what we have here. This is the version, this is the creation time, what level we have selected, red 5. The array size is this, that means the single disk size is this, and array size is actually total size, what, 10 GB we are using, and the disk size is, single disk size is 5 GB. Now it is showing what, 10 GB. So we use 5 GB disk, 3 5 GB disk, total 15 GB, but 5 GB is going for the parity, so usable space we are getting only 10 GB. But actually we are using the 4 devices. 3 is active, but we are using 4 devices. 1 is for the spare. We can see here status is clean and the 1 disk is for the spare. And down here we can see that these disks are active, SDBCD1. And the last name which we mentioned, it is working as a spare disk. Now, if we want to use this, so we have created the red volume, that is MD0. Now I want to use it, then what I have to do, I have to make a file system into it, mkfs dot whatever the file system you want. Like for example, I want to have EFS, XFS, then I will mention the name of our red volume, MD0. So after creating the file system, what we'll do, we will mount it, and for mounting it we need a directory. So for example, I will create directory here, my red one, red data, and here I will mount it. So for that I will use the command mount and md0, and I want to mount it on my this directory. Now we can see that by using the df-ht command. So this is what we have mounted, md0. Now what is the size we are getting? Total size is 10 GB because 5 GB is going for the parity because it is red level 5. Now this is not permanent because we have mounted here with the mount command, but it is not permanent. When you reboot the system, it will again unmount it. So for mounting it permanently, what we need to do is to create it permanent. And for making it permanent, what we need, first we need the BLKID, we need the UUID for this partition. So when you run the command BLKID, so what it shows this, and then this is the UUID. So I will copy this UUID and then I will open the file etcfs tab, and then I will make an entry here just like this, which we have already added for the other partition. So we can use here, we will save this. The UUID, we paste it here. Then the directory name. Then the file system type, options, and these options. So just like this, we will save it and it will be permanent. Now, now it is permanent, and when we reboot it, it will mount automatically. But before rebooting, we should check it. So for checking it, what I will do, if it is already mounted, as we see, it is already mounted here. So I will unmount this by using the umount command, devmd0. Then I will run the command mount-a. Now remember, if we have make a write entry in the fstab file, then you will get never, we will not get any error. So no error, and the partition will be mounted. So it is mounted without any error. That means our configuration is right. If we make any wrong configuration, then we will get the error. No matter what wrong configuration, small changes, small error, small dot can make a problem there. So we will face a problem. So this is what we use the red. Now our red is working properly. If you see the detail here, so our red is working properly. Now if suppose one of the disk goes down, then what happens? This spare disk will take over, and remember, it will not lose the data. Let's create the data first. So I will go to this directory and I will create some data here. I will touch some file here, file 1, file 2, file 3. So there are some files available here. Now if suppose right now our red is working properly, now if suppose one of the disk goes down, still we will get the data because we are using a red level 5. It can get the data from the other disk. It is using the parity. Now when the one disk goes down, this spare disk will take over and it will take the place of that corrupted disk, and it will be the corrupted disk will be here. It will called as a faulty disk. Now this happens automatically if any disk goes down, but we can make it manually also. We can make it manually. Why? Because if suppose we want to remove the disk, I feel like this disk is very old and I want to change the disk, so I can remove it from here also. You can remove it from red. Now for removing it from red, what I do, I will mark it as a faulty and then I can remove it. So either it is automatically get faulty, or we can also mark it as a faulty. So for making it for marking it as a faulty disk, we can use mdadm command hyphen f for the faulty. This SDC1, I want to make it faulty from our MD0. Okay, sorry, it is reverse. We have to mention the red volume first, and then we will mention the volume which we want to make it as a faulty. I'm trying to make the faulty this SD1. Now it says what? setting the SDC1 as a faulty in MD0. Now when you see the detail here, now what we see here that this SDC is now it's called faulty, and the repair, the spare disk SDE1 is now going into the red, active red, and it is trying to rebuild it. You see it is rebuilding it, and at that time what you see here is the state. It is still clean, but it is degraded and it is now recovering. So when the disk is corrupted, it goes, it will still be clean but degraded to red, red level 5. But when you add the other disk, then it will go to recovery, and it is recovering here. It is rebuilding the data. Now if I check the detail, it is now everything is okay, and we can see it is now state is clean. The SDC is now faulty, and this SDE is in the place of SDC. Still, we can see the data is still there. We don't lose the data. Data is still there. No changes. We can still get the data. We can still use the data. Now, what to do with this faulty disk? So we will remove it from the red, and then we can add the new disk here. So if I want to remove it from here, then what I will do, I will use the command R here, R to remove, and then we will mention the disk we want to remove. Now what it says here, it is hot removed. It is removed from the red MD0. Now when you check the detail, you can see now there is no faulty disk it is showing. It is only available disk we have, the active disk. But our red will remain in the risk, because if suppose one disk goes down, then it will be degraded, and if the two disk goes down, then it will lose the data. So I will add this new disk again, and that will remain in the sphere. Now I don't have any other the partition. So what I will do, I will add the same partition again, because it was not corrupted. We just mention it as a corrupted. So I will add the same partition again. Now it is added. For that we use the A option. Now it will be added, and it will be added as a sphere. So we can see now this is as a sphere. Now if suppose we lose more than one disk, then we can lose the data, and we can lose the red. So if suppose I do what, I fault mark them fault, like SDCDE, everything I mark fault. Let's say I will mark first SDB. Now what, when you see the detail, now this SDC is taking the place. Now at the same time I will mark SDD also, SDD1 as a faulty. Now when you see the detail, now it is saying here that it is clean, it is failed. Now when you check the detail again, it is still updating. Now what we are seeing here, failed. We have now more than one disk as a faulty. Now I will mark this SDC1 also faulty. Now when you check the detail, now you have what, three faulty disks. Only one disk is active, and what you see here is failed, but still it is showing clean here, and actually it is still show you the data. If you check the data, still it is showing the data. And that is the benefit of red level 5, and that is why nobody uses red level 2, 3 and 4 and uses red level 5. You can see we are losing more than two disks, more than one disk here, but still we are getting the data here, because it spreads the parity into all the disks available in the red, all the active disks. Now if this disk also goes down, then we lose everything. So if I mark this also faulty, like E1, now we don't have any disks, and now it says that it is failed. It is completely failed now. Now I will remove all these disks from here. For that I will use what? R option, remove E, remove D1, remove B1, remove C1. Now when you check the detail, I removed everyone. So why I removed it? Because I want to stop the red. So if you want to remove the red, if you want to stop the red, then what you have to do, you should first remove all the partitions from there. So if you remove them, then only they will be available for you to use. That means you can use them for other things. And if suppose it is already there in the red and you stop the red, then they will consider into the red. And when you try to use those partition for anything else, if you try to delete them also, they will not delete, because they are saying that they are marked as they are used into red. So now I remove them from the red so that I can use them again, and I can delete them, and I can also stop the red now. Now before stopping the red, we should unmount the partition red partition which is mounted on this drive. Because it is still mounted, so we have to do what? We have to unmount it here, and then we can stop the red. And for stopping the red, we can use a command mdadm, and we can say hyphen capital S to stop md0, and then it is what? It is saying stopped. Now when you check the detail, it says no such a file or directory because there is no red running. So this is how we can configure the red, and we can manage the red, and also we can delete the red.